Well, I'm Don Corey with the Bedford Historical Society, and at least one of you, John Filios, is an old partner of mine from Bedford. But today, nice, comfortable in here compared to being outside.
Right.
Good time to talk about some nice stories and history that are attached to our old Billerica Road neighborhood. It's been a nice, important neighborhood, both the Billerica and Bedford, and it's a lot of the people have been involved in important things going on. So I was going to start with a little about its history. Now, just to orient you, this isn't going to show very well on this. Bedford is outlined in black, and Concord originally, when it was formed in 1635, Concord came all the way up here. So the lower part of Bedford started out as part of Concord. And this is Page Road in Bedford, and this is old Billerica Road that goes up into Billerica Center. And you people are located right where Route 3, just before it crosses the river, right up there. So a lot of people have passed along that road, old Billerica Road, for thousands of years. And we know that this particular area was a crossroads for Native American tribes for thousands of years, long before we colonial settlers, they arrived about 400 years or so ago. But before the first English colonists arrived, there were three Algonquin-speaking tribes. The Pawtuckets were to the north up on the Merrimack River. The Massachusetts tribe was down this way by Boston Harbor. And the Nipmucks were to the west. The three tribes, you know, had their own identities, but they all spoke the language, same language, Algonquin, and they all communicated with each other. There were actually intermarriages between the tribes. So a resident found these spear points on his property. It was just a short distance up Old Billerica Road from where Springs Brook, one of the tributaries, joins the Shawshene River. Anywhere where these little streams came into the river was a favorite place for the Native Americans to hang out. And these were dated by an expert to at least 3,700 years ago, perhaps as old as 6,000 years ago. And close by, the same person found this pewter button with the engraved star that dates back to colonial times too. And that was a very expensive button back in colonial times, and the owner probably regretted its loss. So the road has had a few names since colonial times. First, it was the way to get to Bacon's Mill from Billerica. It was East Road in Billerica in 1830. Then it was East Street, Mill Street, Billerica Road. Our town meeting in Bedford adopted the official name as Old Road to Billerica, but everybody is familiar with Old Billerica Road. So the earliest documented colonist visit to this area was in 1642. And in that year, Concord had been established in 1625. Woburn, which included what's now Burlington, and Cambridge Farms, which is now Lexington, they had all been established by 1642. But the area north, which included Bedford and Billerica, was still a wilderness, and was called the Shawshene Wilderness. So in 1642, the General Court sent Simon Willard, who was a Concord fur trader, and Edward Converse, who was a prominent Woburn resident. They got together at the Shawshene House. This was an Indian trading post back in those days. The Shawshene House was right where the Native American Trail crossed over the Shawshene River. They went north on Old Billerica Road, up into what's now Billerica, came back, and almost certainly came back past where your facility is located, because Concord Road here in Billerica was part of the same Native American trail system. and came back down to what's called the Two Brothers Rocks in Bedford, and from there came down to the Shawsheen House. And they didn't like what they saw. They said most of the land had been given away in grants. Governor Winthrop and Lieutenant Governor had been given grants on this side, and other people had been given grants on the other side, and the rest of the land they thought wasn't fit for anything. But nevertheless, Billerica was established a few years later in 1655, that included the northern half of Bedford. So right here was the southern boundary of Billerica and went north. And about 1663, Michael Bacon leased the land on the Shawsheen River and built a mill on the falls of the Shawsheen River. This is obviously a much later mill. This is from the 1800s. His mill was 200 years earlier, 1600s. But he had a sawmill for cutting lumber and a grist mill for grinding meal, grain. And so this is one of the very earliest colonial sites that we have in Bedford, again, 1663. That mill is gone, but we've got a small park and a sign that marks its location. And Eagle Scout recently reestablished the trail that goes from Old Billerica Road down to the old foundations. Anyway, Michael Bacon came back and forth from Woburn to operate his mill, but then he settled just up the road in 1671. And the east half of his house, it's the right-hand house, half of the house, at 229 Old Billerica Road, we believe that's the oldest house surviving in Bedford, again from 1671. Well, during King Philip's War, this is 1675, just a couple of years later, 1675 and 76, Native Americans tried to drive the colonists back to the coast and reclaim their land. Michael Bacon fled back to Woburn, where he was from during the war, and his mill was burned. But after Philip's death, the Indian chief's death, and the end of the war, surviving Indians were all relocated and no longer lived in this area. So the mill was rebuilt, but without the Native Americans coming and going, which they had done on a regular basis, the trail between Billerica Center and Bacon's mill quickly was overgrown. So 5 years later, in 1682, the Billerica town records contained an entry where Mr. Muzzy makes a complaint for want of ye knowledge of ye highway from his farm to the town. The selectmen order somebody to go and remark the trail, and so it may be obvious to all travelers. So the road passed very close to this Bacon house, and so when the west half, the left-hand side of the house was built, they realigned the road. And if any of you are familiar with Old Billerica Road, the real sharp jogs in the road are a result of when he built his house, they moved the road. Well, Michael eventually acquired most of the land grant that had originally been given to Reverend Michael. He was Cambridge's second minister, and the land went from the Bacon Mill all the way west to Springs Brook, which goes up here, and north to what became the Bedford town line. Michael also received a grant of more land from Billerica to encourage him to keep his mill going. And then with later land purchases by his sons, by around 1700, this is one generation later, there were five Bacon families that were living in five separate farms all up and down here, totaling over 800 acres that the Bacons owned along Old Billerica Road. It really became Baconsville. And one of Michael Bacon's sons, Jonathan, inherited the mill, and he had a house in the southern part of the property. Well, he was a former Billerica selectman, but Jonathan also became an important individual for us here in Bedford in founding the town in 1729. He was one of the petitioners to form the town. He was the first town moderator and was a member of the first board of selectmen. So the Bacon family even appears in our Bedford Town Charter, which is a legal document that established the town, describing the town bounds. Description is, the boundary runs to a white oak east of the highway from Bacon's to Billerica. So the road from Bacon's to Billerica There was a white oak up here that runs in a Wago east of the highway from Bacon's, marked WFB, then a straight line from this to the northwest corner of their farm, of the Bacon's farm, and from thence on a straight line elsewhere. So this is the 800 acres that the family had. I hate to consider what the property taxes would be to pay on 800 acres up and down Old Billerica Road now. Anyway, shortly after the formation of Bedford, Christopher Page built his farm, built his home near the southern end of Old Billerica Road. He was a grandson of another very early settler, Nathaniel Page, who arrived in 1688, and his homestead was very close by. Christopher Page's homestead still stands from about 1730, and it's listed by the National Park Service on the National Register of Historic Places. So another one of the historic sites there. Well, the Bacon Mill and at least part of Jonathan Bacon's farm were sold in about 1730 to Benjamin Fitch, who built his road, his house just up the road from the mill. Benjamin Fitch's house is gone, but his grandson, David Fitch II, who continued to be the miller, he built a new house about 1803, and that also still stands just very close to the mill. And Benjamin Fitch's wife, Miriam Gray, was the source of one of Bedford's most well-known legends. Bedford has the Witch of the Shawsheen. And early in 1732, after Benjamin Fitch had settled here as the miller, he married a woman, Miriam Gray, who had lived down the river in what's now Andover. After the wedding, the couple came up the river to the miller's landing here in Bedford, and their arrival in the village created a lot of consternation. Miriam appeared in her scarlet wedding cloak, made of fine imported English wool that her parents had provided, whereas her appearance was in sharp contrast to the subdued dress of all the other villagers, the farmers, and they had all of the colors of gray and black. They also heard that her mother had testified at the Salem witch trials, which she had, and Miriam came to be called the Witch of the Shawsheen and was shunned by the neighbors and blamed for droughts and all sorts of other natural disasters. And the prejudice went on for a number of years until there was an epidemic of throat distemper in Bedford. It's either strep or diphtheria. It caused a lot of children to die because there were no medicine at that day to take care of it. Well, Miriam went to the aid of her neighbors and tormentors, nursed many children through the illness, and gave comfort to the parents. And after that, the ugly incidents were forgotten and the villagers accepted the witch. Well, several years ago, the Historical Society was able to trace the provenance of a witch's red cape, claimed to be, which had been given to the Historical Society in the 70s by a descendant. And starting with the descendant donor's name, used historic genealogy records, the federal census, interviews with descendants, and were apt to actually able to track the ownership back through generation after generation, directly back to Miriam Gray. Now only the remnants of the silk lining remain and facing remain. Silk doesn't stand up for 300 years, but this is, again, 300-year-old wool. But other clothing experts we've had come in to look at that, they've authenticated the garment stitching is appropriate to 300 years ago, and so we're pretty confident that we have the witch's cape from Miriam Gray. Well, Bedford's entire population was scattered throughout the town from the time it was established in 1729 through the Revolutionary War, almost to the end of the that century. There were only four families plus the meeting house and school in the center. In contrast to that, the Old Billerica Road between the Bacon, now Fitch Mill, the Wilson Corn Mill, which is close by just to the east, and all the people living there, it was really the commercial center of the town. And through the 17th, 18th centuries, it was one of the most populated areas in Bedford, and that was where our history was made. So going fast forward now to the Revolutionary War, Most of you probably know about the Boston Tea Party. That was Boston's response to the tea tax in 1773. Well, one of the colonists who deposited the King's Tea in Boston Harbor was Thompson Maxwell. His family had settled on Old Billerica Road, right across the road from the mill, and the Benjamin Fitch, whose wife was the witch. Well, by 1773, when the revolution was coming on, Thompson Maxwell was a grown man. He was about 30 years old. He worked as a teamster and traveled back and forth into Boston frequently. And his log contains the following entry. I loaded my team at John Hancock's warehouse and was about to return when J. Hancock himself requested me to drive my team up into his yard, and he ordered his servants to take care of it. He requested me to be at Long Wharf at 2 p.m. and inform me what was to be done. I went accordingly and joined the band under Captain Hughes. We mounted the ships and made tea in a trice. This done, I took my team and went home, as an honest man should. Okay, well, Thompson was also a friend and a former neighbor of our Minuteman captain, Jonathan Wilson, who lived just up the road. Maxwell's had lived here, and Captain Jonathan Wilson, captain of our Minuteman company, lived there. They were also related by their marriages to sisters, and on the evening of April 18, 1775, Thompson was visiting his friend, Captain Wilson, when the word of the British regulars marching to Concord reached them. And Thompson Maxwell went to Concord with our Minuteman company, well-armed in his words, and he was there when Captain Wilson was killed during the British retreat down Battle Road. And incidentally, other neighbors who answered that April 19th alarm included William Maxwell, Thompson's older brother, David Fitch from right across the road, Christopher Page, who was in the next farm down the road, obviously Captain Wilson, and probably four Bacon family members from the farms up the road. And so virtually every farm and neighborhood, they all turned out on April 19th for what we now observe Patriots Day. Well, in June that year, 1775, the colonists fortified the hill in Charlestown opposite Boston that led to the Battle of Bunker Hill. And you just knew that Thompson Maxwell was going to be there too, along with another of his brothers, Hugh Maxwell. By then he was a lieutenant in a Minuteman company from Charlemont. Well, both took very active parts in the Battle of Bunker Hill. They helped lay out the entrenchments the night before, and they manned them during the battle. Hugh Thompson was severely wounded during the battle, but he continued to serve the country through the rest of the war. Well, in the century that followed, the owners of the mill and the farms all obviously changed. By then, it was called East Street. There's the Shawshene River. The mill is here, and it's now East Street. By the time of this map, this is 1875, we had a new Burlington Road that connected it was a shortcut, better way to get from Burlington to Bedford Center. It's now Route 62, if you're familiar with that area. That was an improved shortcut. Bedford had also built a school in each quarter of the town in order to serve the children in that quarter, and naturally the East School was built on Old Billerica Road. The schoolhouse still stands, but it's now a private residence. They still have an East School sign on that. But other changes were in the air with the progress that had gone on already. The last Bacon to live in the Michael Bacon house had moved into town. The Bacon house is right here. The last Bacon had moved into town in 1845. And the house, which had been built and used as a divided house for two families since the 1700s, wound up with different owners of the two halves for the next century. The west half and the related farmland to the north and west wound up going through a bunch of investors, but wound up they were purchased by a John Clifton. And he also bought Captain Jonathan Wilson's farm, which was over on this side and farther north. And he established a very large 220-acre Clifton stock farm, And it was really a major departure from the small-scale family farms that surrounded it. It was intended to help supply the growing needs of the Boston area for meat, dairy, produce, livestock. And after John Clifton's death, Orrin Fisk continued the operation. And so Orrin Fisk owned all of this, and his name appears a couple of places here. Well, immediately south of the mills and opposite the end of Burlington Road down here, the Pages had sold a part of their farm to William Lyons. And his farm ran from there down. This whole area, except the East School, was the part of the Lyons farm. And I just mention all this because in the next few years, virtually all of the farms on Old Billerica Road were acquired by a couple of people in major new projects around the turn of the 20th century. And only Christopher Page's farm, which is down this way, and the very northernmost Bacon farm remained independent, but everything else was absorbed in the big new projects. Well, the arrival of the railroad in Bedford in the 1870s and our electric trolley in 1902 really changed Bedford from being a remote agricultural town to one that was really in Boston's backyard. The Middlesex and Boston Street Railway came through Bedford and connected from Boston all the way up to Lowell and all the way west as far as Hudson, and it literally was faster and more convenient to go get between Bedford and Boston 100 years ago than it is now, probably a 15-20 minute trip. And Bedford became an attractive country retreat for a number of wealthy families, so that laid the groundwork for what it was happening. Well, the Parker family was one of the wealthy families that arrived in the late 1800s. Arthur Parker was a gentleman farmer, and his brother Frederick was a coal dealer, but they were both pretty sharp. And in 1893, they purchased the Clifton Stock Farm, which they renamed Shawsheen River Farm. But Arthur Parker, all of the area in this area is the Parker Holdings. And we're going to get down to this, but this is the Parker Holdings that we're going to be talking about. Now, getting into detail from just the Parker part. Arthur Parker, who was a gentleman farmer, owned everything that's outlined in green here, and he also bought another farm from Skinner and another one from Ireland. And his brother Frederick bought the part of the Clifton Stock Farm that was on the east side of Old Billerica Road, this Old Billerica Road. Well, Arthur, mostly he had a dairy herd, but he also bred championship trotters. And he built them a half-mile track for his trotters to work out on, and we had a half-mile racetrack in Bedford for a number of years up off the, just beyond the sharp turns at Old Billerica Road. Frederick Parker renovated the Jonathan Wilson House, which is located here, and then he installed commercial greenhouses and started growing fresh produce, lettuce, cucumbers, and all that he shipped daily to Boston markets. So he had a massive addition onto the original Captain Wilson House. Was a small, typical house that was out here. But all of this was added to take care of all the help that they had to have to deal with all this and all the packaging they had to do for all the produce. They had to have the crates, boxes, and everything. So there was a lot that going on there. They had a sister, Eleanor, and she wound up purchasing the east half of the old original Michael Bacon house and all the farmland with that. And they also had, in 1903, another brother, Francis Stanley Parker, came and arrived too, and he bought another farm north and east of the others. So by 1911, that family owned more than 350 acres along Old Billerica Road, from Springsbrook on the west to the Shawsheen River on the east, and all the way up to where now Old Billerica Road and crosses over Route 3. Well, for the next 40-odd years, the Parker family bought and sold small parcels. They changed boundary lines. They disposed of property. They had just dozens of land transactions. But they had a virtual enclave along both sides of the road during that period. Both Arthur Parker and Frederick Parker served on our board of selectmen, and the family was very involved in our town government. During Old Home Week, which was something that was to encourage people in 1912 to come back and visit. People that had moved away from town, they had Old Home Week to encourage people coming back. They would have a parade. And this was the daughter, Mary Parker, and she had a chauffeur to drive her carriage in the parade. Well, shifting gears now, Frances Willard was a great woman pioneer and advocate for women's suffrage, temperance, social services to those in need. She was president of the Women's Christian Temperance Union, the WCTU, from 1879 until her death in 1898. And it turns out that our Bedford's first charitable organization associated with her work dealt with the temperance movement. We had the Willard Hospital that was incorporated in January 1900. And a special publication by the patients of the Willard Hospital explained that it was formed for, quote, the treatment of inebriety and the more advanced stage of that disease, dipsomania. Went on to state its president is that distinguished Bostonian Edward Everett Hale. And his name is in memory of the great temperance reform worker Frances Willard. Anyway, this was for a time the only private hospital for treatment of alcoholism in Massachusetts. We're way ahead of the rest of the crowd. Well, in June of that year, 1900, Willard Hospital bought the Butterfield Farm. And the Butterfields had a very prosperous farm. That's a lot fancier than most farmhouses you see in their barn. It was a 60-acre parcel with a house in the barn. And it also had a 65-acre parcel with a spring that supplied water for the farm. So the house that we looked at and the barn were down here, and that was the main part. But they also went up along the Springs Brook, and they had a spring up here that provided the water. Well, in the 65-acre parcel was sold to a Dr. Sidney Elliott. He was a secretary of the hospital and heavily invested in it. And in 1903, they also bought, the Willard Hospital also bought the Lyons Farm, which went down. It was a 4-acre homestead lot here. The house was there, barn across the road, and the whole farm, 100 acres, straddled the Shawshene River. So the Willard Hospital was treating alcoholics on roughly 160 acres, this part of the Field Farm and Lyons Farm. But while I was preparing this talk, I solved another puzzle that we had in our society. We've got a booklet by a Bell Mead Shetland Pony Farm. It was on Old Billerica Road. I hadn't been able to figure out its location. It was described as on the old road to Billerica at the junction of Burlington Road. And its location, the Lexington-Boston electric cars, the trolleys passed within a mile of the farm. But I finally realized that the farm owner was this Dr. Elliott, who was heavily invested in Willard Hospital. And then I also found that he was the resident physician to the hospital. So he was running a pony farm at the same time that he was the resident physician in the alcoholics hospital. And if you're interested, the booklet on the pony farm suggests to buy your children a real living miniature horse, one that will last them all the years of their childhood, fill their lives with happy memories, develop their judgment, sense of care, ownership, as well as provide a source of endless, healthful amusement. So that was our pony farm. So during the first decade now of the 20th century, every property on that had changed, on that stretch of road had changed hands. Lyons and Butterfields had sold their farms to Willard Hospital. So if you were going up the road, you would pass the recovering alcoholics. You'd pass the ponies here. As you're going up Old Billerica Road, you'd be going past the alcoholics working here, Then you get up to the pony farm, you go by the mills, and by the time then, there's one parcel is still owned by Fitch's, but then after 170 years in the Fitch family, it was finally sold to a Horace Wiggin, who I'll come back to. But the next farms up, you are into the Parker's properties with their large-scale commercial market produce, the dairy herd, the championship trotters and all. So in the course of that first decade of the 20th century, old Billerica Road had totally departed from 300 years of just small farming family subsistence farms. Well, while at Willer Hospital was functioning here, there were other people pursuing other Francis Willard interests elsewhere. There was a Miss Caroline Caswell. She was so inspired by this woman that she turned her talents towards starting social service work. And she was a very capable individual who knew how to identify needs, and then she could find the ways physically and financially to solve them. So her first project in 1894 was a small recreation center for factory girls in Boston, quickly outgrown, and in a series of rapid moves for helping young working women and children, she established a home for working girls in 1897. 1903, she incorporated the Francis Willard Settlement, and by 1907 had acquired an entire hospital, Vincent Memorial Hospital, with adjacent church for her social work. Well, she also turned her attention to people in middle life, the women in midlife, who were exhausted, you know, long working hours, convalescing from illness, out of work, discouraged, whatever. And that led to the convergence here in Bedford of two of Francis Willard's charitable passions, the temperance movement, which you already had here, and then social services for the needy. Well, regrettably, the Willard Hospital and the Bellmead Farm didn't survive for long. Dr. Elliott died in 1909, and that ended both ventures. His farm was sold, and the hospital 60-acre farm were passed on to Miss Caswell's Francis Willard Settlement. And both the house and the barn were in considerable need of repair by then, but they were able to move on. And also, just as a note, once that Willard Hospital discontinued its work in 1912, after 27 years as a dry town, Bedford, a town meeting that year, voted to resume granting liquor licenses. So the temperance movement came to an abrupt end. But meanwhile, the Willard Settlement worked on restoring the former Maxwell Butterfield Farm. If you look at this building and then go back and look at the Butterfield Farm, they dressed up this Butterfield farmhouse and with the awnings and all into a very fancy place. And it provided a rest home for women, and they also had an industrial center so the women could earn a portion of their keep by weaving linens or making rugs, canning preserves, other tasks. And they also added another building soon after that to provide more lodging. So an early brochure of theirs described their mission and programs, that Lusac Lodge is meeting a long-felt need, supplying a temporary home for worthy women between 40 and 60 years of age. There are many scores of these women who need judicious help, not charity. Those out of work, out of funds, or needing a rest from overwork or overwrought nerves are admitted and find a pleasant home, home life, cordial goodwill and encouragement, which help them to again take up the battle of life when physically equal in to so doing. They also had a room, a loom room for turning out work, baskets in variety, dainty leather articles, furnished vegetables, preserves, pickles, jelly, ketchup made of produce grown at Lusac are put up for sale, and strictly fresh eggs. Tender broilers and roasters are supplied from their poultry plant. Well, not wanting to stand still, Miss Caswell wound up purchasing the former Fitch farm from this Horace Wiggin, who I've mentioned briefly. He had bought the farm in 1902, and he only lived there for a few years, then moved on. And so they already owned this, and then the Willard Settlement bought this farm, and that the homestead and the barn and the land across the land from Lusac, plus two parcels on the side, same side as Lusac, this and that going all the way up. Gave the Francis Woolard settlement here in Bedford about 185 acres, and it also allowed Miss Caswell to start a summer recreational camp for working girls from settlement clubs in Boston that was on the east side of the river, of the highway. So for many years, Lusac Lodge and the industrial center for women where they could earn money toward their board and the summer camp for girls were very successful. They had annual open houses, holiday celebrations, and encouraged the general public to purchase products that they made there. And newspaper articles were consistently positive about the Willard settlement, as were messages on postcards that guests sent to their families. And these are some aerial views of the Willard settlement that was taken, they were taken in the 20s, that were used on postcards and their promotional material and in newspaper articles. Here you're looking from the west, you're looking east, Old Billerica Road run there, the Shawshene River is beyond that. This is that Butterfield Farm building. This was their barn, and this was the new building that they added, the main house, in order to expand their capabilities. This is another picture closer in. That's the old original Butterfield Farm and the barn and the cottage where hired people would have worked, and that became the loom room, and this is the additional building. So the Harvey Cottage, the small building where hired help would have lived when it was a farm, but it also housed the looms where the rugs and other woven articles were made, and where preserves were canned, and it was lost on a bitterly cold morning, apparently 14 degrees below zero, when it caught fire and burned due to an overheated chimney. Not uncommon, unfortunately. And those operations then were moved from there to the other, the main house. Well, there was one other group of women that Miss Caswell felt compelled to do something for, and the existing Willard settlement couldn't offer anything. And these were women who were ill, but not so ill as to need nursing care, but they couldn't be taken care of in the lodge because each guest had to be able to attend meals in the dining room, had to take care of her own room. These people needed some attendant care. So the Fitch Homestead, which was Miss Caswell had bought right across the road from the main settlement house, it was renovated and became the Worthen Memorial. A wing was added to accommodate 21 women, and they had a registered nurse in charge, and she was assisted by several practical nurses. So this all was quite favorable. And I need to note now that during the 20s, the federal government was looking for a location to build a veterans hospital that would specialize in treatment of brain injuries for the men that had been injured in World War I. Well, both Bedford and Lexington were favored by the federal government, due to their proximity to Boston and convenient transportation. But the responses of the two towns to that initiative are interesting and perhaps reflect something of the respective characters. Lexington was afraid of losing land from its tax base for such a hospital, and they bitterly and vigorously opposed its location there. Bedford, after much consideration, at a final meeting, unanimously approved the proposal and invited the government to locate the hospital here. So I think probably that the positive image that the Francis Woolard settlement had generated for decades probably did a lot to influence public opinion in here in Bedford. But anyway, so by the end of the 20s, Bedford, a little town, had two major facilities: the Francis Woolard Settlement, also known as Lusac Lodge, and the Veterans Hospital that was located just on the other side of Springs Brook, just west of the Woolard Settlement. And so both of those were addressing needs of two very large populations and very much underserved populations. Well, going back to the Parkers, by the 20s, the Parkers were aging and slowing down. So Arthur Parker, Arthur Parker sold his land, and the bottom part went to a Goulding, and the rest of it went to another family. And Frederick Parker, who also was slowing down, sold his land, which by then included part of Eleanor's, to Robert Little. Well, Robert Little also returned back to family farming, although he had the greenhouses. But in 1938, the great hurricane of 1938, they destroyed the greenhouses. That was the end of the market produce operations. After World War II, the feed costs and labor shortages also started making farming in this area very marginal, and construction of Route 3 by that time. Route 3 ran right through the eastern part of the Parker's properties. That precipitated now new changes. So the Parker family heirs sold the last of their property there, including the homes of Frederick, Eleanor, and Francis, which were all in this area. By 1955, however, the four Parker homes, there's one here, the old Wilson house that Frederick owned, and the two houses back here that Eleanor and Francis owned. The stables that Arthur had, which were up here, and the Bacon home, which was right here, all were saved, and those are all in a small historic district that the town had was able to get listed in the National Register of Historic Places. So the small historic district has a half a dozen of these historic buildings there. As you can see, the rest of the land was subdivided with single family homes, and Bandera Drive and Temple Terrace basically go through what used to be the racetrack, Bedford's racetrack.
Are the historic houses that were saved then still open to the public?
They're all private residences now. So they can be viewed, but unless they have tours, they're not open to the public. Well, in the 60s and 70s, Paul Little, who had inherited from his dad that farm, he reinvented his farm. Bedford Country Club. It was a 9-hole public golf course, and there was a family ski area during the winter. So a lot of people have fond memories of the public golf course and the family ski area. This comes from Lost Ski Areas of Massachusetts website. And it had a rope tow, and then they added a T-bar lift. And a lot of people that grew up around here, including our kids, had a wonderful time there. But regrettably, after a couple of decades, both the Littles and the Gouldings farms were sold, and the Bedfordshire condominiums were built there in the 1980s. Well, Lusac Lodge did continue to flourish through the Great Depression, the hurricane, World War II. The original Butterfield House was demolished in 1938, and a new building was built to replace it. And they also expanded their mission in the after the Second World War to include a women's retirement home rather than just helping people while they're at work. However, their circumstances forced them to retrench also. That Worthen Memorial, where they helped women who couldn't take care of themselves totally. They deferred repairs during the Second World War. There was so much work that was necessary, they decided to sell the property and discontinue that service until they could get a new facility. So in December 46, that the Fitch House and the barn and all the land on the east side of the river, of the road, were sold. So that ended that Worthen Memorial for women and also the girls' summer camp. Well, the farming also ceased in 47 when the farm feed costs and labor shortages made it unprofitable. And in that same year, the town of Bedford bought the Clark Mill. So this is where Francis Willard Settlement. Town bought the Clark Mill, demolished the mill, and dynamited out the dam on the river. And in 1960, the surplus farmland that belonged to the Willard Settlement, Lusac Lodge, was sold to a developer, and that then became the old Stagecoach subdivision. In 1975, the people from Carlton Willard House in Elizabeth Carlton House in Roxbury started discussions with the town and with Lusac Lodge that resulted in a merger, and so they combined in order to address new changes that addressed other newer needs, in particular our aging population, and that resultant Carlton Willard Village opened in 1982 on the same location, and in 88 it became the first accredited continuing care community in Massachusetts. So it still functions, but everywhere else as you drive up Old Billerica Road, the modern subdivisions have pretty much obscured the long and varied history, but tucked away along the road, we still do have some historic vestiges that reminders that it had a very important and interesting past for the town. So that concludes the talk, and if anybody has any comments of their own or questions, I'd be glad to tackle them.
Very good. The Learning and Retirement Association that I attended when I was living in North Chelmsford took us on a tour of the greenhouses, and they were really wondrous, the camellias and
they still had their greenhouses that weren't destroyed.
They're just this past year.
The hurricane must have just grazed them, because Historical Society has a huge number of photographs of the destruction in Bedford, and not just this set of greenhouses, but there was another set of greenhouses owned by Alger family. Same thing, they were flattened.
They asked for donations, and most of the members contributed to helping.
Yeah. Perhaps they had also additional financial means so they could rebuild their greenhouses too, I suppose, yeah. But that was the end for ours. Okay, well, thank you all very much.
Thank you very much.
Are you going to make a book out of this?
I...